mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
The greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Good morning, I'm Mike DeValio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, the UK announces the first known death due to the Omicron COVID-19 variant.
The Philippine government postpones its massive COVID vaccination drive in some areas amid the threat of an incoming storm.
Lawmakers call for a more thorough probe on the alleged cyber theft targeted clients of the Philippines' biggest bank. We'll be speaking with Mel Plabasan of the Central Bank for updates on their own investigation on the issue.
And some Boracay residents being forced to leave their homes as part of the government's rehabilitation of the island. We'll have Chris Kahilig of the Natives of Boracay and business stakeholders later on the program.
Thanks for joining us. We begin in the UK, where at least one person has died after contracting the Omicron COVID-19 variant. This is the first publicly confirmed death globally from the highly transmissible new variant. British Prime Minister Boris Johnson now urging people to get booster shots, saying two vaccine doses are not enough.
I think the idea that this is somehow a milder version of the virus, I think that's something we need to set on one side and just recognize the sheer pace at which it accelerates through the population. So the best thing we can all do is get our boosters. We're opening up centers across the country. We're getting in the army to help with the logistics. We're expanding in every possible way. And what we need now is for the public to respond and to do what is necessary. Get boosted now.
Britain's health chief on Monday said the Omicron variant now accounted for 44% of infections in London. He warned it would become the dominant strain in the capital within 48 hours.
British Prime Minister Johnson's call for booster shots comes as a study finds two-dose vaccines do not induce enough neutralizing antibodies against the Omicron variant. That means increased infections in those previously infected or vaccinated may be likely. The findings came from a University of Oxford research which analyzed blood samples from participants who were given two doses of AstraZeneca or Pfizer vaccines.
It's going to lead to more infections. I think that's clear. Because of breaking through immunity, whether due to vaccines or previous infection, it is breaking through that more easily and causing more infections. Even if overall those infections are milder, at a population level, there is still, if there are more infections, then there will be still more people with severe disease and needing hospitalization.
While the Oxford study has yet to be peer-reviewed, this backs early data cited by the World Health Organization that the Omicron variant is more transmissible than the Delta strain and reduces vaccine efficacy.
Here in the Philippines, new COVID cases fall to their third lowest level for the year. The country logged 360 new infections and 61 more deaths Monday. Active cases now stand at a little over 11,000. The health department also reported a 1.1% positivity rate, the lowest since testing data became available in the Philippines. But the threat of the Omicron variant spurs authorities to speed up the rollout of booster shots. Government is now looking into the possibility of shortening the period between the second dose and booster shot from 6 months to just 3 to 4 months.
Because we also, you know, received some advice from some experts worldwide na mas maganda na yung tinatawag natin hanggang hindi bumababa yung ano yung nag-wane yung protection, kailangan bigyan na natin.
So yung pong Janssen at saka po yung Sputnik Light na mga single dose, ang advice po natin dyan ay 3 months after magbigay na po ng booster.
The second round of the national vaccination drive to be postponed in some areas that will likely be affected by an incoming storm. Citing the State Weather Bureau's latest bulletin, Health Secretary Francisco Duque III said Tropical Depression Odette is seen to hit the southern Tagalog region, central and eastern Visayas, as well as northern Mindanao in the coming days. The inoculation drive in these parts of the country will be moved to December 20 to 22, while the rest will push through with a December 15 to 17 schedule.
Hindi po na muna natin itutuloy ang bakunahan dahil kailangan po mailayo sa peligro ang atin po mga kababayan sa panahon nitong bagyong Odette. Ang rekomendasyon po namin ay ang Calabarzon and Central and Northern Luzon. Yan po ang atin munang ipagpapatuloy ang bayanihan bakunahan part 2.
The word war between Health Secretary Duque and Foreign Affairs Chief Teddy Loxin Jr. continues. On Twitter, Loxin denied Duque's claim that he wanted the health department to follow a supplier's price in the purchase of syringes for the country's COVID vaccination program. Loxin said Duque should not question his motive, as he just wanted to offer, he just wanted the offer to be handled professionally. Loxin previously accused Duque of dropping the ball again, as the country supposedly lost the opportunity to obtain 50 million syringes from the U.S. But Duque insists the claim is totally baseless.
Ito daw mababa yung approved budget. Samantalang bumili na kami for the 0.5 ml syringes at 2.38 pesos per piece. Okay? So what are they talking about? Why will I allow the DOH to agree to a higher approved budget contract? That is in violation of RA 9184 and a potential case of anti-graft can be filed, even allow ourselves to be influenced by others.
The National Task Force Against COVID-19 meanwhile assures the public the country has enough supply of syringes for the second phase of the national vaccination days.
The Philippines gets a $250 million or a 12.5 billion peso loan from the Asian Development Bank to acquire more COVID jabs. The loan will cover the government's purchase of about 40 million additional doses for eligible children and booster shots for adults.
President Rodrigo Duterte vows to ensure an honest and credible election in 2022. In his weekly address, Duterte said the government will remain neutral despite him being part of the Senate race. He also promised a smooth transition of power to his successor.
When it comes to the elections, government, the administration will stand neutral. Neither for or against kami, kalaban o kasama sa partido, we will participate in the exercise of that right. But we will see to it that there will be no terrorism, vote buying, at intimidation and everything that would put a hindrance to an honest election.
Duterte meanwhile calls on politicians to be mindful about holding campaign rallies amid the pandemic. This comes a week after the caravan of presidential aspirant Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr. and his running mate President Duterte's daughter Sara caused heavy traffic in Quezon City.
I implore everyone who are participating in large gatherings, whether political in nature or not, to continue exercising utmost caution and prudence in the conduct of your exercises. Remember that we are still in a pandemic situation, and any large gathering may trigger a super spreader event. Do not tempt the gods. I'd like to call the attention of the COMELEC. Kayo man ang ano ngayon, you are the ones supervising the elections. As a matter of fact, you are the one running the show. Hindi ba ninyo, could you not just issue maintain lang yung social distance?
Human rights advocates declare their support for Vice President Lenny Robredo and 8 senatorial aspirants in the 2022 polls. The advocates broke from their traditionally nonpartisan stance during elections to form a coalition called HR Vote 2022. They say the country's current situation has forced them to come out and openly endorse candidates. The group's convener adds one of their aims is to stop human rights abuses and prevent the continuation of the Duterte administration's bloody drug war.
2022 marks an unprecedented attempt by the former dictator's family to regain Malacañang and undo more than 30 years of democratic gains won by the people's blood, sweat, and tears. 2022 is a tactical fight for our quest for justice and accountability.
Among the 8 senatorial bets endorsed by HR Vote 2022 are human rights lawyers Chel Jocno and Neri Colmenares, as well as re-electionist senators Laila de Lima and Rizal Tiveros.
Vice President Robredo says she will file a petition before the Commission on Elections to open voting centers for BPO workers. Robredo says such a move will ensure BPO workers who are usually on graveyard shift will be able to vote. She adds this could benefit over 1 million BPO employees. In the long run, Robredo says BPO workers should be allowed to participate in the elections through absentee voting.
COMELEC denies all bids to intervene in the petition seeking to cancel the certificate of candidacy of presidential frontrunner Bongbong Marcos. This includes the motion filed by a group of professionals who wanted to join other petitioners who earlier filed to disqualify Marcos due to his 1995 tax conviction. The poll body's second division also ruled against the intervention filed by officials of Marcos's party, Partido Federal ng Pilipinas, which sought to join the defense of the former senator. The COMELEC ruled that these motions will only cause undue delay to the resolution of the petition.
Philippine authorities investigate an alleged cyber theft that targeted clients of one of the country's largest banks. BDO says it is coordinating with the National Bureau of Investigation to search for criminals behind reported unauthorized fund transfers among its clients. BDO adds it is still determining how many clients were affected by the attacks and how much money was stolen. Congressman Carlos Zarate has filed a resolution seeking a congressional probe into the matter.
Padadaanin mo pa sila dito sa butas ng karayom. Malinaw naman sa lumalabas talaga dito, yung system nila ang na-compromise. Mag-isip din sila kung paano maproteksyonan yung interest ng ating mamamayan, the depositors especially, by adapting modern technology, for example. And if they fail to comply with that, then that's a prima facie evidence na meron silang pagkukulang, no? Doon sa due diligence.
Philippine Senator Joel Villanueva, meanwhile, proposes the creation of a multi-agency task force to quickly resolve the issue. As for the National Privacy Commission, it's waiting for BDO to determine if any personal data was compromised following the alleged hack. To talk to us more about this, we are joined this morning by Director Mel Plabasan of the Banco Central ng Pilipinas Technology Risk and Supervision Department. Good morning, Director Plabasan. Thanks for joining us.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki.
Director, what more could you tell us about the alleged online hacking of BDO bank accounts? Any idea how many clients were victimized? How much money was actually lost?
Yeah, Mike, we have created a task force that will investigate. So basically, our team is composed of cybersecurity and anti-money laundering specialists, including legal officers. I mean, the intention really is for us to get to the bottom of the issue and really to identify the exact amount and number of customers who have been affected by this incident.
Mm-hmm. So no figures so far, Director. You're still investigating.
No figures so far, yeah.
All right, but are these incidents so far limited to BDO clients only? And do all the transactions involve transfers to certain bank accounts in Union Bank?
Yeah, based on preliminary information that we gather, this incident really is isolated to BDO, and bulk of the transfers were made through InstaPay to the receiving bank, which is Union Bank.
Mm-hmm. And at this point, Director, can you give us a sense of how the modus operandi looks like? I mean, some have claimed they did not disclose their banking details online, nor did they click on suspected phishing links. So some have also reported not receiving one-time PINs, which could have prevented the transactions. What are you seeing so far?
Yeah, so far, as claimed, that's why we are conducting an investigation. But as claimed by the president of BDO, it was really due to what they call sophisticated fraud technique, which was due to a web service due for replacement by 2022. So we will really, I mean, the intention is for the investigation is to get to the bottom of the issue, identify how the if there are threat actors who have compromised this web service.
Mm-hmm. But at this point, Director, would it be accurate to conclude that only those bank accounts enrolled online are affected?
Yeah, so far only those bank accounts with mobile or internet banking facility have been compromised.
Mm-hmm. So passbooks are safe. Those who are not enrolled online are safe at this point.
Yeah, at least because transfers were made via mobile or internet banking, right? Through InstaPay.
Mm-hmm. So where is the
unauthorized transfers?
All right. Director, where is the point of vulnerability here? Is it BDO's internal system or is it in the interconnection between BDO system and its clients?
Yeah, that's why the governor mentioned last night that we have to complete our investigation in 30 days. We really need to make sure that all vulnerabilities, whether on the part of BDO, on the part of the receiving bank, or even on the part of InstaPay will be resolved or will be remediated.
Mm-hmm. Manila Bulletin Tech Editor Art Samaniego mentioned the possibility of a zero-day exploit, which doesn't have any form of remedy at this point. This is one of the things that your investigation is looking at.
Yeah, we're exploring all possible exploits.
Mm-hmm. And what possible liability will BDO be facing at this point, Director?
Yeah, again, we are guided by existing regulations. So if there are omissions or if there are weaknesses, then, the involved institutions may be subjected to, let's say, monetary or non-monetary penalties or other escalated enforcement actions.
Earlier, Director, you mentioned there was the website supposedly that was due for upgrade. Was this on the part of the BDO that this particular website due for upgrade could have been exploited by the hackers?
It's not actually website, Mike. It's web service. Mm-hmm. So how does this
web service?
Because you know, when you offer internet or mobile banking facility, it's composed of several systems or applications. Normally, the web service is utilized so that these components will be able to talk to one another. So it's mm-hmm. it's a system or application.
And this system or application is exclusive to BDO? Only BDO is using this system?
There are most other banks that offer mobile and internet banking facility are utilizing web service.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. All right. Now, how about on the part of Union Bank? The fact that Union Bank accounts were able to receive all these funds, which were supposedly invested in cryptocurrency, is there any also liability on the part of a Union Bank?
Yeah, the intention of the investigation is we need to identify or to scrutinize the KYC process, customer onboarding process of Union Bank. But initially, based on preliminary information, there are actually real persons behind, because Mark Nagoyo is a fictitious name. So yes. There are real persons behind Mark Nagoyo, and our investigation, that we will ensure that the person behind Mark Nagoyo, and including the accomplices, will be dealt with to the fullest extent of the law.
And Director, how many accounts are we talking about? Is it just Mark Nagoyo's bank account? Are there also other bank accounts who have received funds from BDO?
Our money laundering specialists will also conduct their own investigation to determine the number of mule accounts involved in this modus operandi.
Mm-hmm. And how is your coordination so far with the two banks, with the NBI and other authorities involved in investigating this incident?
Yeah, so far we have been we have already requested preliminary data, and we will hopefully, again as mentioned, we will need to complete this investigation within 30 days. And yeah, they're cooperating.
Mm-hmm. And BDO said it will reimburse innocent clients. What does innocent in this context actually mean, and what is the procedure for reimbursement?
Yeah, because there are those clients. Innocent clients are those, as you mentioned, those who did not provide their credentials, who did not click on any malicious links. So those are considered innocent clients, because there are also phishing victims who voluntarily provided credentials, who gave away their OTP to the, fake customer service associate. So,
So those who are not innocent may be in danger of not getting reimbursed by BDO, by the bank.
Yeah, the intention, that's why BDO and BSP are conducting separate investigations to identify really who are the innocent victims in this particular incident.
Mm-hmm. But is that really the policy, Director, of the BSP or the banking system, that if, for example, I as an, let's say, as a client who doesn't know better about protecting my online credentials would mistakenly click on a phishing link, does that mean I would not be able to gain or at least benefit from the protection supposedly being provided to clients of PACS?
Yeah, because Mike, as you know, online security is a shared responsibility, right? While we need to ensure that banks implement robust standards when it comes to protecting their infrastructure, customers are also responsible in protecting their digital identity, knowing how to, ensure that they won't provide their credentials or OTPs to those pretending to be representatives of the bank. So again, it will have to be investigated by the bank, and the bank usually does not restitute clients who are called negligent.
Mm-hmm. All right. Now, Senator Joel Villanueva has called for the creation of a joint task force, while some legislators have called for an investigation in aid of legislation. In your opinion, are these necessary?
We are already conducting our own investigation, and it's part of the mandate of the BSP. Aside from the usual on-site and off-site supervision. And in terms of the creation of a task force, we have already been communicating. There are preliminary meetings already among BSP and PCDICT and other relevant government agencies, primarily to address the growing number of online-related fraud.
Mm-hmm. Now, Director Plabasa, these incidents of online hacking are not exactly new. What changes, in your view, should be put in place to prevent similar hacking incidents from happening? And what should the public always keep in mind?
Yeah, I think, Mike, the downside really of us going digital is this is the downside. Hackers or fraudsters have become also very creative. And that's why vigilance is required, of course, for the consumers. And the bank should always be, the banks that we supervise should always be proactive when it comes to adapting robust security measures. And clients, again, as I mentioned, clients should also be vigilant because it's a shared responsibility.
Mm-hmm. All right. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts with us this morning, Director Mel Plabasan from the Banco Central ng Pilipinas. And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, the death toll from a string of tornadoes that hit the U.S. climbs to 74.
And some Boracay residents being forced to leave their homes as part of the government's rehabilitation of the island. These and more with the Rundown Return. Stay tuned.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.
Welcome back to The Rundown. American business magnate Elon Musk is Time Magazine's 2021 Person of the Year. The U.S. magazine attributed Musk's push for technological innovations and being the choice of this year. Musk is the CEO of electric vehicle and clean energy firm Tesla. The American billionaire also heads and owns the aerospace company SpaceX.
Turning now to the financial markets. Wall Street pulled back at the start of the week as investors assessed how the Omicron variant will affect the Federal Reserve's meeting this week. The Nasdaq took the biggest hit, plunging around 1.4%. The Dow and the S&P 500 also dropped around 1% each. Reopening plays also took a beating, with airlines and cruise lines among the biggest losers during Monday's session. And over in Europe, stocks also ended lower as the UK reported its first COVID-19 death due to the Omicron variant. Over here in Asia, shares traded mixed as investors look ahead to monetary policy decisions of a number of central banks, including the Federal Reserve, the Bank of Japan, the Bank of England, the European Central Bank, and the Philippine Central Bank. Japan's Nikkei 225 led gains, while the PSEI began the week flat at 71.97.
The Philippine Central Bank urged to rethink its new design of the country's 1,000 peso bill. The new design replaced three of the country's World War II heroes with the image of the Philippine Eagle. The chairman of the National Historical Commission says they were not consulted on the issue, contrary to the earlier claim of PSP Governor Benjamin Diokno. Bayan Muna Party List Representative Carlos Zarate calls the move an attempt to erase the contribution of Philippine heroes at a time of historical revisionism in the country. Local historians also up in arms.
These three people who are in the 1,000 peso bill right now all stand for different aspects of Philippine society. General Lim, the military, Jose Abad Santos, the government, Jose Falianes Escoda for the civil sector and women. During World War II, rather than succumb to the Japanese, rather than give up, they fought back, and they all paid with their lives. And like, to replace them with one eagle is not doing them justice.
I am sad because the predecessor of this series of bills, the new BSP series, had history both at the front and the back. You have the personality of history, and then, of course, the historical event or the historical landmark. Now they want to erase everything. In the K-12 curriculum, Philippine history was removed in high school. So, and then we nagre-reklamo tayo na nakakalimutan na ng mga kabataan na naniniwala na agad sa pambabaluktot sa kasaysayan. What is the state doing?
And some Boracay residents being forced to leave their homes as part of the government's rehabilitation of the island. For more on this, we are joined by Chris Kahilig of the Natives of Boracay and business stakeholders. Good morning again, Chris. Thank you for joining us.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
So BIARMG authorities issued the order, right, saying residents have 10 days to vacate their homes for the forced demolition. Now, how many families and households will be affected? Who are the people that are going to be most affected by this move?
Yeah, I just want to clear that up. It's the mayor who issued the demolition order, and in compliance to the request of the DILG. And the affected families are the local residents who have been occupying their lands since time immemorial. They have tax declarations since 1916, and these are not squatters. So these are about 30 families, about more or less 100 plus families in total.
Mm-hmm. So these are people who actually legally own their land. And you said there were arrangements made between the affected households beforehand that were ultimately breached. What are these arrangements and how were they violated?
Yes, according to the affected families, they have been invited to attend the coordination meeting with the BIRMG on September 28th, just this year, and it was discussed there. The general manager, which is Ms. Bernardino, promised to these affected residents that they will transfer to their vacant lots because some of these families owned a lots in other parts of the of Boracay, and they were asked to transfer there without even investigating if the land is still vacant. Anyway, so the agreement is that there will be no demolition unless their connection of water and electricity lines are facilitated. Mm-hmm. But then again, we have a municipal ordinance that prevent that. The service providers here are prohibited to connect lines, whether new or transfer, if they don't have building and occupancy permits, which really cost a lot, and it takes time to be processed. So it's a complicated problem, but the residents were just surprised on December 3rd. They received a demolition with giving them 10 days of notice to just vacate and self-demolish their properties, which is so sad. Christmas is coming, and this is what's happening.
Mm-hmm. And your group, the Natives of Boracay and Business Stakeholders Incorporated, issued a resolution or appealing to the mayor to defer it, right? Due to some unconstitutional aspects of the ordinance, as you said. What exactly does your group appeal for? And as well as any updates to how the mayor has responded?
Yes, we have been fighting for this since for months, and we were surprised as well. So we wrote an appeal addressed to the BIRMG, to the mayor, especially to the mayor, because he was the one who issued the order of demolition. So the appeal is to honor the agreement and to appeal for the right relocation, the proper relocation, which is only in here in Boracay, because our argument is that in 2019 or 2020 there is a land allocated for the wetlands residents to be transferred there, just here in Boracay, and if they can do it that way, why cannot they do it with this affected people? And the update on that is that yesterday we received a reply from the office of the mayor saying that they are actually asking the office of the BIRMG for the minutes of the meeting, so that may probably to have a reference on the agreement, because these are verbal agreements only, and so sad. But it's been during the coordination meeting, some members of the press were invited as well, and actually can attest to this agreement as well.
Mm-hmm. And under the principle of local autonomy, the local government of Aklan must invoke decentralization to exercise authority in addressing the call of residents for the confirmation of their imperfect titles, either through administrative or judicial registration, right? This statement was from you. Could you expound on this?
Yeah. Well, the Boracay lands has been, we've been fighting for it for decades already. And all of these things that are implemented during the rehabilitation is based on the Presidential Proclamation 1064, and because the land has been owned in the concept of the owner of Boracay residents, they have the imperfect title of it. But there are the Presidential Proclamation 1064 is making their imperfect titles not to be processed because the land is classified as forest land, where it means that it's a government owned and it cannot be transferred for private ownership and like that. So there is like a complicated
it is. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a complicated thing. What we need to do is all of the residents here in Boracay are pushing the local government of Aklan to spearhead the to spearhead the amendment of 1064 and invoke the decentralization. We are not against the rehabilitation because the rehabilitation is a national government's effort or initiative. But, you know, if it's going to affect the lives, the homes, the livelihood of the people, then the local autonomy must be enforced. The local government should, you know, see to it that the welfare of its constituents remains the core objective of the governance. And it's very disturbing that it's what is happening now. It's the opposite of it.
Mm-hmm. And Chris, are you also getting support from Secretary Kuya?
To be honest, I don't know if if Secretary Kuya knows about this.
Are you thinking of letting her know?
Yeah. Yes, we've been writing the Senate and every mm-hmm. office that's involved with this. To be honest, there is a Senate resolution passed by Senator Risa Hontiveros to investigate on the affected or the rehab affected families, like the illegal arrests, the alleged forced eviction like this, but it was referred to the Committee on Environment, and now we are still waiting for the update on the on it from the Senate. Mm-hmm.
All right. We continue hoping for the best. Thank you for speaking to us once again, Ms. Chris Cahilig. Please stay safe.
Thank you too.
And over in the U.S., the death toll from a string of tornadoes that tore through six states has risen to 74. Kentucky Governor Andy Beshear says the number is still expected to rise, with over 100 people still missing. In Kentucky alone, over 60 were killed, including six children, as the tornadoes flattened homes and uprooted trees. President Joe Biden is set to visit the hard-hit state on Wednesday. This is a town.
We've already approved an emergency declaration and a major disaster declaration for Kentucky. I've spoken with the governor several times thus far. And this gives me the tools to provide everything that we can in the from the federal level, from expert search and rescue teams to immediate and longer term help with housing and clean up a whole range of things. And I stand ready to do the same for the governors of other states.
The U.S. Supreme Court rejects religious challenges to New York's vaccine mandate. The cases were filed by Christian doctors and nurses, as well as a group that promotes vaccine skepticism. The justices acting in the two cases denied emergency requests for an injunction that would require the state to permit religious exemptions while litigation over the mandate's legality continues in lower courts. The challengers had argued the mandate, which allows a medical exemption but not a religious one, violates the U.S. Constitution, as well as a federal civil rights law that requires employers to reasonably accommodate an employee's religious beliefs.
Aside from Rappler CEO Maria Ressa, another Filipino also shined at the Nobel Peace Prize event in Norway. Award-winning photojournalist Hannah Reyes Morales is currently holding an exhibit of her photos depicting Ressa's fight for freedom of expression in the Philippines. For more on her experience, we are joined by Hannah herself. Hello, Hannah. Are you still in Oslo?
Yes, I am.
What time is it there?
It's almost 1 a.m.
Whoa. Okay, so must early bird ka pa. All right, first off, how does it feel being selected to provide official photos for the Nobel Peace Prize exhibit in Oslo? How did you go about this?
Yeah, so it wasn't really necessarily just to photograph like the official photos. It's really more a response. So it's a whole photo essay responding to Maria Ressa's call to hold the line, as well as examining the roots of disinformation in the Philippines and why it spreads. So of course, for me, it has felt super exciting. I think Maria Ressa won the Nobel Peace Prize this year, like many journalists, like yourself, Filipina journalists. I found that to be a very meaningful thing for us and a win for all of us. So when the Nobel Peace Center tapped me to do the exhibition this year, I was thrilled for maybe 2 seconds, and then afterwards I felt daunted because there was such little time to do the work. So it was intense weeks to look at and understand really how disinformation happens in our country.
Mm-hmm. And what to you are the most important parts to highlight when dealing with the topic of press freedom in the Philippines? I noticed that you also featured photos of ABS-CBN. And was there also a time that this topic felt personal to you?
Yes, of course. I think, you know, one of the things that has been difficult for me over the last several years is witnessing, you know, what's happening on the ground, having photos as proof of what's happening on the ground, and then coming home to my laptop and then seeing my own friends and my own loved ones be in disbelief over these issues that we know to be true, and the things that we work very hard to bring to our audiences and to our readers. So for me, that's of course a very personal thing. I think it's very difficult to research facts. It's very difficult to get the facts, but it's very easy to manufacture a lie. And once a lie is there, and once it proliferates, fact checking on its own is its whole other thing. And one of the people that I photographed from Verifiles, Chin, told me that the difficult thing about misinformation and disinformation is that the burden of proof is in the person fact-checking. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of different aspects. And of course, like, it was very intense to try to wrap my head around all of that. But I think in the end, in the middle of all of that chaos and really sort of like sinking myself into the maelstrom of disinformation and its effect on our democracy, one of the really gave me hope was listening to Maria Ressa and listening to her call for Filipinos to hold the line.
And have you spoken to Ms. Ressa in person? Have you had time to bond?
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I had to photograph her for the exhibition. You know, one of the things that I had to do for this was to make the portrait of her, which will be on show at the Nobel Peace Center. Mm-hmm. Together with other the Russian photographer Nana Heitman, who photographed Dmitry Muratov, when you enter the gallery and when you enter the museum of the Nobel Peace Center, the first things you're going to see over the course of the year while they are the laureates are the portraits that we took.
Hannah, the Nobel Peace Center also cited the EU for your notable documentation of President Rodrigo Duterte's war on drugs. So how important are photos in showing reality, truth, conveying emotions, and ultimately telling stories?
You know, one of the things that I always say about, and I always ask myself this because, you know, I wonder always, what's the role of photography? What is the role of photography when it comes to bringing facts to people? And for me, I think photography's role is showing the face behind the facts, humanizing the data. Mm-hmm. And so that's sort of what I tried to respond with when I was looking at everything that Maria Ress was talking about. How do I, as a photographer, contribute to what she's saying? How can I, as a photographer, sort of like show and help a viewer understand the issue? Because the issue of disinformation, the issues that we've seen over the last few years in the Philippines, these are complex issues. Sometimes, I guess, like what a photo can do. And as we've seen over the last several years with all the photographers who've very closely documented the war on drugs, the power of imagery to really show people what's happening on the ground.
Right. And Hannah, for someone with numerous awards and published works in major international magazines, you know, we have The Washington Post, New York Times, and even National Geographic. How does this experience compare?
I think it's one of my first experiences with gallery work and museum work. You know, I'm as a photographer, I guess like my main medium is really digital as well as editorial. So I'm very used to being able to see my photographs just on my phone, on my computer. Often when I get published, even in Nat Geo, it it takes me several months to see the actual print. And so to actually have to create images that have to sit on a wall for a very long time, mm-hmm. I think almost it's going to be there.
For everyone to see.
Process. Yeah, and of course, like thinking about the sizes and the prints, mm-hmm. It was just a very different and challenging process. But luckily, the people at the Nobel Peace Center gave me a lot of freedom, and they were very open to hearing my ideas for how it should be. But at the same time, I was learning as I went.
And lastly, you know, we know that both Ressa and Muratov opened the exhibition themselves. Can you tell us more about the exhibit? What will we see there? Will it soon be open to the public, perhaps kahit online?
Yes, I know that they're going to have a digital version of the exhibition out soon. So mm-hmm. for that. The exhibition opened to the public, I think, yesterday. I'm very confused about time these days. But it was, I think, and the really cool thing about it was when I gave a private tour together with Nana Heitman, and there were several Filipinos there who had come because they wanted to see, you know, wanted to learn about Maria's work. And I, you know, for the very first day that the exhibition opened to the public, kasama ko kabayan, so sobrang saya. Mm-hmm. Like, W na taga Oslo. And it was really, really heartening na parang, you know, like one of them told me na, because here in Oslo, parang they're seen as invisible labor because they're, mm-hmm. you know, au pairs or care workers. They really feel that this win of Maria has made them seen in this society. So someone right. told me that. And well, to hear that, parang naiyak ako, because I was just like, oh, it's really nice that something like journalism, something like visual arts can be a touch point for people to connect really across oceans, people mm-hmm. with a shared culture, shared history. So I thought that was really, really lovely.
All right. On that note, thank you so much for pulling an all-nighter for us.
Thanks, Anna.
Thank you for speaking to us. You stay safe. And in other news, a developing storm seen to hit the Philippines this week. State Weather Bureau Pagasa expects Tropical Storm Rai to intensify into a severe tropical storm when it enters the Philippine Area of Responsibility Tuesday evening. It will then be assigned to the name Odette. Pagasa also warns it's likely to reach typhoon category by Wednesday, which could trigger storm signals over Visayas, large portions of Mindanao, several provinces in southern Luzon.
2021 Formula One champion Max Verstappen not bothered by the controversy at the final lap that pushed him to victory against his rival Lewis Hamilton. He even described it as a perfect finish to what he called a crazy season. Verstappen and Hamilton had been head-to-head in the championship tally, and it all went to the last lap for him to overtake Hamilton and into the checkered flag to nab his first ever championship.
I mean, I'm very happy, of course, to get to win. I mean, it was an insane season in general, and basically you couldn't have written it even crazier for that final race, you know. So it pretty much just sums up the whole season.
And let's get more sports news now from our North America Bureau Chief, DJ Manoto.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here are the latest stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community. Let's go! In less than four rounds, the Filipino flash, Nonito Donaire Jr., proved he's not yet ready to pass on the torch as the top Filipino fighter. Dropping fellow Filipino Raymart Caballo with a vicious body shot during their title bout on Saturday in Carson, California. After the victory, Donaire sat next to the fallen Filipino, who was referred to him as his idol.
I told him, don't be disappointed. Don't be disappointed. You did a great job. You're going to be a champion. And whatever I can do to help, I will help you. I promise you that.
Now with the WBC belt settled, Donaire is intent on collecting other world titles, including a potential rematch with two belt holder Naoya Inoue. But he's also looking at conquering other weight divisions.
Well, that's the goal, is becoming undisputed champion of the world.
Still in boxing, Filipino Marlon Tapales' championship dreams are stronger than ever after demolishing his highly touted Japanese opponent, Hiroaki Teshigawara, in just two rounds on the Donaire Caballo card. The 29-year-old from Lanao del Norte knocked down his opponent twice in the first round before finishing him off 6 seconds into the second round.
Basta steady lang ako sa game plan namin. Tapos, yun, tinamaan siya. Hindi rin ako nag-expect na matumba siya ng ganun kaaga.
The victory brings his record to 35-3 with 18 knockouts. More importantly, the win puts him in line to face current IBF and WBA title holder Morajon Akhmadaliev.
And those are the top stories amongst the Filipino community in North America. You can catch more of our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, TJ. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navalio. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Head Start comes your way next. Stay with ANC.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods now, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand if we do follow the health protocol.